Hello, my name is Elder Price, and I would like to share with you the most amazing book. My name is Elder Grant. It's a book about America a long, long time ago. It has so many awesome parts. You simply won't believe how much this book can change your life. Hello, my name is Elder Green. I would like to share with you this book of Jesus Christ. Hello, my name is Elder Young. Hello, did you know that Jesus lived here in the... You can read all about it now.
Hello,
it's free. No, you don't have to pay.
Hello,
hello, my name is Elder Smith, and can I leave this book with you for you to just peruse?
Hello, my name is Elder Doug. Elder Bundy. Bundy has two syllables, so it doesn't fit the song as well, but I used to be an elder out there many years ago, but today I'm your host for this show, Voices from the Dust TV, for Monday, the 20th day of October 2014. We welcome you to our show where we share the reason for the hope within us, the reason why the Latter-day Saints should be or are Christians, and the reason why you should be too. Our message not only explains what distinguishes LDS Christian doctrine from non-LDS Christian doctrine, but also why we declare that the only salvation remaining for the Gentiles is for them to repent and to be baptized and thus to be identified in the same covenant and to worship at the same altar as Israel. We've discussed this in past episodes, and you can find those on our website, voicesfromthedust.org, voicesfromthedust.org. Just go there, click on TV in the menu list there, and you can access the live player. And below that, the archived episodes, and above it, you will find links to our YouTube channel, our Google Plus page, or our Facebook page. So we're happy to be here. Today we're talking about the controversies of Zion, since this is Monday, and it's Meet the Book of Mormon. So anyway, we'll talk more about that, but before we do that, we're happy to see our special guest Sam's joined us this morning. We haven't seen him in a very long time. Welcome, Sam.
It's nice to be here, Doug. We've got some time for a while. Come back and be with you and converse with you.
Yeah, we've missed you. It's been quite a while.
Yeah, I've missed being here.
Well, I miss you because you contribute to the program, but you were always on time for the most part. These other guys, they show up eventually, but they're getting it's getting to be that they're less and less on time, so if they do show up. But anyway, that's great. We're really happy to have you back with us today. We'll talk more about that in a minute, or maybe you can go ahead and tell us what you've been doing. We don't really have all that much today.
I've been doing a lot of missionary work, and I've been doing a lot of studying. Sometimes the time I spend here takes away from study time, and my wife and I decide maybe we need to study more in order to get more into the spirit of missionary work. That's what I've been doing.
I kind of suspected that, because we do a lot of the stuff that has to do with the world that the missionaries don't really need to get into, and it might even detract from the work to see some of this depressing stuff that's going on out there in our awful situation. So that was probably a good idea. Well, okay, so we're still pretty much doing our thing. Today we're going to be talking about Meet the Book of Mormon, which is a takeoff of the Meet the Mormons film that is all the rage now, and we've with the success of that days before Meet the Mormons was released, and it's called A New Day for the Book of Mormon, and it's on BYU TV. It's wonderfully inspiring. I really liked it because it's about people, including scholars and non-members, who recognize the book's extraordinary implications and the magnificent feat that it is, and the content that it has. It's just too often not talked about. We talk about Mormons and their lives, and you know, gee, I'm a black bishop down in the South, but I'm a Mormon, or I'm a kickboxer and I'm a Mormon, or I'm a candy bomber and I'm a Mormon. But the thing of it is that we don't talk about why people are Mormons, you know, and the Book of Mormon has a great deal to do with that. They should have put Roy in that film. Roy was converted by the Book of Mormon, and when he found out that it was of Christ, really, everything about it is about the doctrine of Christ, about the gospel of Christ, and we're happy to have he's joined us here. Good morning, Roy. We were just talking about you.
Hello, Roy.
Good morning. Good morning, Sam. Good morning, Doug. Good morning, people in the world.
Yeah, we're really surprised to have Sam here this morning.
Yeah. How you been, Sam?
I've been doing great.
Good, good.
We've had a few small successes so far, and it's worth it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
And Doug mentioned Meet the Mormons. I saw that. It took an investigator to see it. I should have taken some Kleenexes with me when I went.
Oh. You know,
I was sad to see all the things that the people went through and so on as well, you know.
Yeah. I watched the... I haven't watched that, but I watched another one where they did a track. You know, they made a movie out of it, them coming back from the, coming over, you know, to get to Utah. And I'll tell you what, that was heartbreaking, you know, just to watch that. You know, that was something else. It just blessed me to watch that particular movie. You guys have probably seen it, but I hadn't. So it was really nice to watch something that really touched your heart.
Yeah, so what was the reaction of people around you in the theater there, Sam?
I didn't see much of a reaction. They all seemed very content and smiling afterwards.
Yeah.
I might want to brag a minute or two and say I've met Gail Halverson and talked to him. In fact, I formatted a book. I helped him publish one of his books.
Oh, really?
And I worked on the cover and did the formatting for it.
Oh, how great is that? So what did your investigator think?
She thought it was going to be more doctrine-oriented.
Yeah.
And more spiritual experiences.
Yeah, left her hungry for him, huh?
Yeah.
Well, I haven't seen it, but... I was my wife and I went home teaching at the bishop's house, and I mentioned that it was probably more propaganda than anything else. That went over like a lead balloon. They're all really excited about it and everything, but I was saying the same thing your investigator was. I wish they would have something that would show the Book of Mormon and how it's a fulfillment of the great and marvelous work that the Lord, that the Father promised to do for the sake of Jesus. You know, that really opens up a lot. That's, of course, what our program's about, so it's not surprising that that's what I'd like to see. But you know, they have such talent, these people, to put these things together. You could imagine the power of something like that rather than a PR kind of thing, as good as it might be, that they've done. But anyway, we're going to talk about that a little bit today. But we're going to go first of all to our regular feature, Voices Out of the Ground. And we call this section our Whispers Out of the Ground, and we're at chapter 42 of the Book of Alma. So here he's been talking about, we've lost track of the number of first person narratives like this. This is another one. I think we're over 30 of them. They're just marvelous. But in this one, Alma's talking to another one of his sons, or maybe the same son, but he's talking about the justice of God. He's talked about the resurrection, and he's talked about a lot of amazing things, but now he's going to talk about the justice of God in the punishment of the sinner. You know, I think some of the Protestant sermons, I can't remember which one or who it was, but one of them is real famous for that, just really but a different type of thing rather than what we're going to hear now. But let's listen to it first, and we'll talk about it on the other side.
And now, my son, I perceive there is somewhat more which doth worry your mind, which ye cannot understand, which is concerning the justice of God and the punishment of the sinner. For ye do try to suppose that it is injustice that the sinner should be consigned to a state of misery. Now behold, my son, I will explain this thing unto thee. For behold, after the Lord God sent our first parents forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence they were taken, yea, he drew out the man, and he placed at the east end of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the tree of life. Now we see that the man had become as God, knowing good and evil. And lest he should put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life, and eat and live forever, the Lord God placed cherubim and the flaming sword, that he should not partake of the fruit. And thus we see that there was a time granted unto man to repent, yea, a probationary time, a time to repent and serve God. For behold, if Adam had put forth his hand immediately and partaken of the tree of life, he would have lived forever, according to the word of God, having no space for repentance. Yea, and also the word of God would have been void, and the great plan of salvation would have been frustrated. But behold, it was appointed unto man to die. Therefore, as they were cut off from the tree of life, they should be cut off from the face of the earth, and man became lost forever. Yea, they became fallen man. And now ye see by this that our first parents were cut off both temporally and spiritually from the presence of the Lord. And thus we see they became subjects to follow after their own will. Now behold, it was not expedient that man should be reclaimed from this temporal death, for that would destroy the great plan of happiness. Therefore, as the soul could never die, and the fall had brought upon all mankind a spiritual death as well as a temporal, that is, they were cut off from the presence of the Lord, it was expedient that mankind should be reclaimed from this spiritual death. Therefore, as they had become carnal, sensual, and devilish by nature, this probationary state became a state for them to prepare. It became a preparatory state. And now remember, my son, if it were not for the plan of redemption, laying it aside, as soon as they were dead, their souls were miserable, being cut off from the presence of the Lord. And now there was no means to reclaim man from this fallen state, which man had brought upon himself because of his own disobedience. Therefore, according to justice, the plan of redemption could not be brought about only on conditions of repentance of men in this probationary state, yea, this preparatory state. For except it were for these conditions, mercy could not take effect, except it should destroy the work of justice. Now the work of justice could not be destroyed, if so, God would cease to be God. And thus we see that all mankind were fallen, and they were in the grasp of justice, yea, the justice of God, which consigned them forever to be cut off from his presence. And now the plan of mercy could not be brought about except an atonement should be made. Therefore God himself atoneth for the sins of the world to bring about the plan of mercy, to appease the demands of justice, that God might be a perfect, just God, and a merciful God also. Now repentance could not come unto man, except there were a punishment, which also was eternal as the life of the soul should be, affixed opposite to the plan of happiness, which was as eternal also as the life of the soul. Now how could a man repent, except he should sin? How could he sin if there was no law? How could there be a law save there was a punishment? Now there was a punishment affixed, and a just law given, which brought remorse of conscience unto man. Now if there was no law given, if a man murdered he should die, would he be afraid he would die if he should murder? And also if there was no law given against sin, men would not be afraid to sin. And if there was no law given, if men sinned, what could justice do, or mercy either, for they would have no claim upon the creature? But there is a law given, and a punishment affixed, and a repentance granted, which repentance mercy claimeth, otherwise justice claimeth the creature, and executeth the law, and the law inflicteth the punishment. If not so, the works of justice would be destroyed, and God would cease to be God. But God ceaseth not to be God, and mercy claimeth the penitent, and mercy cometh because of the atonement. And the atonement bringeth to pass the resurrection of the dead, and the resurrection of the dead bringeth back men into the presence of God, and thus they are restored into his presence to be judged according to their works, according to the law and justice. For behold, justice exerciseth all his demands, and also mercy claimeth all which is her own, and thus none but the truly penitent are saved. What, do ye suppose that mercy can rob justice? I say unto you, nay, not one whit. If so, God would cease to be God. And thus God bringeth about his great and eternal purposes, which were prepared from the foundation of the world. And thus cometh about the salvation and the redemption of men, and also their destruction and misery. Therefore, O my son, whosoever will come, may come and partake of the waters of life freely. And whosoever will not come, the same is not compelled to come. But in the last day it shall be restored unto him according to his deeds. If he is desired to do evil and has not repented in his days, behold, evil shall be done unto him according to the restoration of God. And now, my son, I desire that ye should let these things trouble you no more. And only let your sins trouble you with that trouble which shall bring you down into repentance. O my son, I desire that ye should deny the justice of God no more. Do not endeavor to excuse yourself in the least point because of your sins by denying the justice of God. But do you let the justice of God and his mercy and his long-suffering have full sway in your heart, and let it bring you down to the dust in humility. And now, O my son, ye are called of God to preach the word unto this people. And now, my son, go thy way, declare the word with truth and soberness, that thou mayest bring souls unto repentance, that the great plan of mercy may have claim upon them. And may God grant unto you even according to my words. Amen.
Wow. So we see, you know, does this can you really see a young man of Joseph Smith's age having the gravitas, if you will, and the maturity to lay out the plan of salvation, lay out everything so clear and concisely as this? It's amazing. I'm afraid too many times we take so much for granted, but this is a tremendous exposition of our lives here on earth, and it's done in 31 verses. I mean, it's amazing to me. I am, of course, very biased because I think this, you know, there's no way that Joseph Smith could have written anything like this, but not only that, but that what is written is so transparently true and causes our heart to rejoice because it clarifies why we are here on this earth, and why there is evil in the world, and why and how the justice of God, you know, one would say, well, why are we sent here to fall, and you know, now we're going to be condemned if we don't repent. But he's the one that came down and died for us that we might repent and find mercy. I mean, it's a magnificent thing. I have never yet come across anything so moving in terms of Gentile sermons or Bible verses or expositions that come even close to something like this. But let me get your input. We're grateful that Andrew's joined us. Now, Andrew.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, good, good, thank you. We're glad to see you here. We have Sam and Roy with us as well.
Roy and Sam, we got a whole crew here.
Yeah. All yeah, right. Sam used to be with us before you.
Hey, Sam.
Hi, Andrew.
Good to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Oh, yeah. Hey, Roy.
Hey, how you doing, Andrew?
Doing good. How are you?
Good, good.
All right. Oh, I really love these sermons, man. I think you said it best, Doug. We smacked them down. We laid it down. We smacked them down. It's over. Let's go to the river because we're going to baptize these people. They're going to quit their sermon. They're going to quit their preaching job, and we're heading to the river. No, I think it was really good, though. I mean, it is amazing, and you can feel the time period. At least I can. I can feel the time period, and I can feel its power and its use in our day today. But you can feel the time, and I can feel the you know when it happened at the time. I think that was in somewhere in Ohio.
Yeah, probably was. I don't know where it all happens, but I'll tell you. The maturity of the speaker and his understanding and his motivation, all those things come through, and with painting a picture of a man that is way beyond the years as far as a gray beard is concerned, way beyond the years of a young man. How old would he have had to been when he wrote this? In 1829, if he were the actual author of the book, he was in his 15th year in 20, so he was 9 years later, 24 years old. I don't know. How old are you, Andrew?
I'm 31. Yeah. I mean, I obviously sound just as eloquent. Yeah, it's amazing. There's no way. I mean, yeah, okay, they may have had some stronger education back then if you're like Thomas Jefferson, but Joseph Smith didn't. He's a farm boy.
No, he was a farm boy, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We want to see how this new film that has come out, it's called, it was released 5 days before Meet the Mormons. So, you know, you can't hear anything about it because Meet the Mormons is all anybody's talking about. It's kind of swamped out the talk of any other Latter-day Saint film.
Meet the Mormons is that propaganda film.
Yeah, yeah. I said that to my home teacher, to the family I was home teaching, and they didn't like that. Like that at all. They thought I was being irreverent.
Well, it is what it is. I mean, and they're donating it to the Red Cross. Well, the Red Cross is a for-profit corporation. This is not a charity. They make the CEO makes $1 million a year.
Yeah, I know. It was not. I didn't like that part of it. But now Sam said he took an investigator to it, but he also had to take a box of Kleenexes with him. So it was a really powerful moving film in you know showing the lives of those people. But his investigator, I'll let him tell us, but his investigator was kind of disappointed there wasn't more doctrine and experiences in it. Is that right, Sam?
Yeah. They expected probably, quote-unquote, like Andrew said, more propaganda. My wife also was a little bit disappointed. Not really disappointed, but she thought it was going to be different with spiritual experiences, uplifting accounts, doctrine, and so on. So, but my investigator, she thought it was good, but I guess they were. This movie is probably slightly different than any other movie the LDS Church has made, in that it does just focus on the lives of some of the members and what they do and the sacrifices they make, or the attention to service to others. And so maybe that's why it took a few people by surprise.
Well, it's a good idea. I think if it is propaganda, it's good propaganda. So darn good propaganda. So I guess that's really good. I want to see it. I'm going to go see it. I just didn't want to pay the money, theater prices.
Yeah, I'm going to sneak in.
Yeah, it'll be online later, so I'll just wait. But searching for it, I found this other movie that's called A New Day for the Book of Mormon. And we want to get to that. But first, I want to go to our next feature, our awful situation update, and tell the folks how they can get to that by going to our website and explain to them exactly what it is. It's not what you'd think it would be. People would be probably surprised to find that as well. But it takes a little bit of understanding in the Book of Mormon, or coming maybe from having been awakened by 9/11 or truth or some other thing to be able to understand it. I'm kind of stalling here because for some reason my computer wouldn't come up, but there it is. My website wasn't coming up. All right, so let me share this. This is, you go to our website here, voicesfromthedust.org, and what you will see is this site here, this page here, which is the home page, featuring Jesus Christ as he spoke to the early American Christians. But if you go to this version or this menu item that is number 5 from the left, it says Situation Update, and you click on that, it will take you to this page that we call our awful situation update. And that is important to understand because the Lord in the Book of Mormon, through the voices of the dust, commands us to awaken to a sense of our awful situation. And that is indeed awful. So what we have here is a list of people. They're all YouTube videos explaining the awful situation that we're in, helping to wake people up. But if you really want to get awake, then the important thing here is this in-depth background briefing videos, and you can get there by clicking on this link, and that will take you to a slideshow of videos that will explain the truth about 9/11 and black op black operations or false flag operations in general. And also much about the loss of our freedoms in this day. And that's what the Lord wants us to see. And he says that we should not suffer it to get above us, because if we do, then it's going to have horrible consequences. Well, it turns out that that's the same victory cry, if you will, that Alex Jones has made very popular, and that is resistance is victory. that we should resist these people, but there are those who will try to use the Bible, and it turns out that they were recruited by the government to do so, and use chapters like Romans chapter 13 to persuade people that they should not resist tyranny because it's from the government. Because the Bible speaks about how we should, and in the Book of Mormon, not the Book of Mormon, the doctrine, not the Articles of Faith of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints says that we should be subject to kings and presidents and governments. But it does not say, and you can not justify from the scriptures, that when that government turns tyrannical that you should lie down and let it walk over you. No way. And we see very important examples of that. Go ahead, Andrew.
Oh yeah, I was just going to say that, yeah, it, the scriptures talk specifically about adage one to another. And as soon as that happens, as soon as the freedom of conscience is violated, and as soon as we become in bondage and are putting other people in bondage, you know, to laws we pass, to and they're not laws. You know, the Constitution is mostly a document that is anti-government. It is, you know, the government, you know, shall make no law. That's what you know, most of the Ten Amendments begin with. You know, the state shall make no law restricting the freedom to bear arms, meaning I should be able to have an Apache helicopter. Honestly, and that's the truth. That's the truth.
Of the rockets and machine guns.
That's right. That's right. I should be able to have it if that's what they have too. So once we become in bondage, then we're violating what God told us was the right law. Do you have this on your screen? Because I was just reading this this article.
You were.
Is that? Yeah.
This is going to, yeah. I can't find a video, but there is nothing more more startling than this. This should wake us up to what's coming. We all talked about this coming. This is in Idaho.
People can't believe
it. The state government is telling these Christian ministers that they must perform same-sex weddings or face jail and fines.
It's coming.
Coeur d'Alene, Idaho.
It's coming, man. It's coming. The church is going to have to revert to just do sealings only, and they're going to not do weddings. They're going to do, nope, this is simply a sealing ceremony. And you get married civilly on your own. That's what they're going to have to revert to, because this secret combination is way, way above us.
Right. That's the exact same thing I was thinking. And we must have heard it from the same source, that they're going to go to that, where people go get married civilly and then come and be sealed in the temple. As a compromise position, but how long can they continue to compromise? Section 101 keeps coming up.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to read this here. It says there's some sound bites. I didn't notice that before. Let me click on that and see. Can you click on that and play it? I didn't notice that. I would have had that ready to go. But they won't hear it if I play it. So if you could play that, see where, if you pull that up and click on Jeremy Tedesco and Jonathan Scruggs, those are two sound bites we can play. In the meantime, if you could do that, Andrew, I'll go ahead and read it and see what it says. It says, Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, Alliance Defending Freedom Attorneys filed a federal lawsuit and a motion for temporary restraining order Friday to stop officials in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, from forcing two ordained Christian ministers to perform wedding ceremonies for same-sex couples. City officials told Donald Knapp that he and his wife Evelyn, both ordained ministers who run Hitching Post Wedding Chapel, are required to perform such ceremonies or face months in jail and or thousands of dollars in fines. The city claims its, quote, non-discrimination, unquote, ordinance requires the Knapps to perform same-sex wedding ceremonies now that the courts have overridden Idaho's voter-approved constitutional amendment that affirmed marriage as the union of a man and a woman. Can you imagine that? What these courts have done? Oh, were you able to pull that up? Okay, let's play it.
Should I share my screen or should I just play it loud?
Just play it if it will. Share your screen if you have to, whatever. I don't care, just so we can hear it.
All right, so I think these are the lawyers.
Yeah.
The city somehow expects ordained pastors just to flip a switch and turn off all faithfulness to their God and to their vows. But the U.S. Constitution doesn't permit that. The city cannot mandate across-the-board conformity to its interpretation of a city ordinance in utter disregard for the guaranteed freedoms Americans treasure in our country.
Okay. That was one of them. And then here he says the government should not force ordained ministers to act contrary to their faith under threat of jail time and criminal fines. Well, anti-defamation, is that what ADF stands for? Anti-defamation? I don't know what it is. But ADF, alliance. That's right. It's some kind of alliance. But anyway, that's an understatement. This is an absolute outrage. He goes on to say many have denied that pastors would ever be forced to perform ceremonies that are completely at odds with their faith, but that is what is happening here, and it's happened this quickly. The city is on seriously flawed legal ground, and our lawsuit intends to ensure that this couple's freedom to adhere to their own faith as pastors is protected, just as the First Amendment intended. Well, you know, there should be more than just a lawsuit. There should be these people should be run out of government on a rail. Somebody should put them on a rail and run them out of town.
Yeah, I agree. Did you see what happened in Houston?
Yeah, I was going to pull that one up too.
Yeah, man.
I don't have it up right now. I figured everybody is already aware of that one.
Okay.
But because it hit national news, well, this one is even worse.
Oh yeah, this one didn't. This one didn't hit anything because I imagine because it's small town Idaho.
Well, I don't think it's old enough yet. It should be get picked up by, you know, the alternative media and the real media. They should then, people should march to Idaho. It's just unreal.
Yeah, I'll see you there.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, I'm there.
I agree. But I'm just like most apathetic Americans. I'm waking my mind, but I've been so dumbed down and brainwashed over the years that I'm apathetic and turning the other cheek. Well, that's not good when they have the bat and the gun and the cuffs to you. That's when you defend yourself. And I think that you should ask the Lord if you do that. And I think that He would allow that. You know, I would hope that the Lord would allow you to happen. Fight back against this tyrannical government that we have in the United States Corporation of America. But, it's going to come that time. That's going to come. And, you know, I don't know if I'm ready. I protested before, but,
well,
I mean,
listen, you can just go to dances, watch dances, what do they call it, with the stars, with everybody else.
Yeah.
And just stick your head. Now, I have something here. I got to play this for you because Well, you won't be able to hear it, I guess, so that won't work. But this is an amazing thing I ran across accidentally. Let's see if I can get some air. Oh, it doesn't look like it's going to play very well anyway. But this is Fred Astaire dancing with Ginger Rogers. Oh, it just won't play. I'm sorry. Nothing like a jerky video, dance video. But anyway, if I would have had a chance to download it, we could have played it and it would have been better. But I mean, if they had Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers on Dances with the Stars, I think I would, instead of protesting, I would watch that too. It was really fantastic. You'll have to watch it. Man, it's modern music they put they're dancing to, and this guy and that woman are just amazing. But that was a little bit of comic relief because you're getting too serious there, young man. Do you remember Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire dancing, Roy and Sam?
Yeah, I saw a little bit of it. I didn't see him too much. Maybe I was still too young. I don't know, but I remember them a little bit here and there.
Oh, we remember.
I remember it because my mom was always talking about.
Well, they were in the movies.
Do you remember that, Roy?
They were in the movies. So
yeah, that's true. They were in the movies too. You could see them, but it wasn't to the modern music. Man, this one is amazing. You have to watch it. It's just really nostalgic because you know they were a little more. They weren't just distracted then. There wasn't any indication to most people that the New World Order was, you know, poisoning our water. They weren't at that time. They weren't modifying our food. They weren't spraying us like bugs. They weren't imposing upon us a police state like they are now, getting ready to throw us into FEMA camps. They weren't destroying, at least we didn't realize it, other countries. You know, with the bankers and using our own army and navy, especially our navy, to force these people into poverty, which they've done. Oh, gosh, it's just so maddening. We don't want to spend any more time on it. Go ahead.
Yeah, it is out of control, but I just wanted to remind people that if you... Number one, if you hold to the Constitution, if you like the Constitution, which is the law of the land, right? If you believe in that, then the federal government right now considers you a domestic terrorist. So if anybody likes the Constitution, just put on your rag around your head and scream Allah Akbar, because they consider you a terrorist now. That's what they put you on list for that. You're on a list. If you like the Constitution.
Yeah, we've seen several instances of that. One where the police officer in Colorado, he was actually a fairly high-ranking highway patrolman, and he had a chance to go see this presentation that was being put on in La Junta by the federal government, and it listed sovereign citizen, and he... citizenry kind of thing, the sovereign citizen movement, and so he said he was interested in learning more about that, so he went to the program, and he was shocked to find that they were talking about these terrorists, domestic terrorists, and this was a couple of years ago. You can imagine how much further down the road they are now, but he captured one of their slides that listed the terrorist groups, domestic terrorist groups, started with fundamental evangelicals and included Catholics and even included fundamental Mormons. Not the regular Mormons, but those, you know, that are into polygamy and stuff, I guess. But I was going to show last week, and I didn't, and I'll have to look it up again. I had it ready to show, yes. But it was inside information showing that they are now coming after us. They have decided that they're going to make their move. Did you see that?
No. I was just saying that they made this list also on the Department of Homeland Security website. So it's right there on their website. They don't hide from it. You know, there were some internal documents that showed these sheriffs and these police officers that were being trained to look out for people that have Ron Paul stickers on their bumper, which I have.
How they should approach the car and how they should look in there for other materials and check for guns. And I mean, it was just ridiculous.
Oh, I've been pulled so many times for nothing because I have Ron Paul stickers.
You have?
And I'm like, well, what are you pulling me for? And they're just like, well, there's lots of drugs running through here. And I'm like, I wasn't speeding, nothing. You have no probable cause. And that's it. And they're just like, all right, see you later.
Oh, you're lucky they don't tase you, man.
I know.
The last one I saw was so not just aggravating, it was so angering. What's the word? Infuriating. And I was so infuriated, I was ready to leave the house and get on a transportation, an airplane or something, and go join the rest of Americans who should have been streaming into, I think it was into Missouri, I can't remember, where this cop, because the passenger wouldn't show him his ID or wanted to know why he wanted his ID, says, when he was told, he says, because you see these bars on my shoulder, and he called him a dumbass, you know. And the guy arguing with him and took a bar and broke out the passenger window. And they tased him.
And they got a kid in the back, right?
Yeah. Oh, it was a family. I was so mad.
Yeah. Man, if you're feeling calm, anybody out there feels calm, and you're feeling like, hey, all is well, watch that video, because that will, oh my gosh, I was just about to run out the door, but I didn't do it, because, you know, I got MK Ultra'd for 28 years.
Yeah, and those who aren't infuriated are probably drinking the fluoride water. You know, which is what they give it to us for, so we don't rise up. It's unbelievable. I told you, we're spending too much time on this. We got to move on. But, man, I could go on and on. But at any rate, that was really awful, that situation there. So now, remember, though, we were talking about... last week, we were talking about this Baptist minister who, his name was Lynn Ridenour. And it turns out that, and I read his paper where he's talking about the Book of Mormon. Were you guys here, or was that when you weren't here? I think you...
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, he's a Southern Baptist preacher, and he loves the Book of Mormon.
Yeah, he like preaches from it from the pulpit. Remember?
Yeah, yeah, he preaches it from the pulpit. Well, guess what? When I found this film. And I couldn't get a copy. I'd love to play it, or at least a portion of it. But I found this film that the church produced and put out 5 days. They released it 5 days before Meet the Mormons, and it's called a new day for the Book of Mormon. It was really fantastic, but guess who was in it?
Good old Lynn Ridenour.
Old Lynn Ridenour.
Oh, man. That guy
was... I was really disappointed because it wasn't on YouTube or anything. It's on BYU TV, and I couldn't find any way to download it so we could watch that. But somebody else did. Luckily, just before it went on air, I found that this guy, I don't know who and how or how, but he got that portion of the new film on YouTube. So I'm going to play it. It's just a couple of minutes long, but it's that portion that comes out of that new Day for Book of Mormon video. So here it is. I'm going to have to... I have to try to sync it here. That's not going to be easy in this short of time. But here he is. Okay, can you see that? And try to synchronize it here. Ready, set, go.
I almost forgot why I came. And he turned around and he handed me a Book of Mormon. And so, before I know what I'm saying, I said, "But sir, that's a Book of Mormon." And he said, "Yes," he was kind. And then I said, "But I thought this was a Christian community. I mean, I have a lot of bias. I grew up a very conservative Baptist background." And he said, we're a Christian community, but we also believe in that book. Well, the bottom line was simply, when he left, I took it out of courtesy. I did not get out of the first page. Totally, as we say here in Missouri, sideswiped by God. Okay. When I read, "I, Nephi, having been born of goodly parents," I knew. I really did. I knew that I was reading God's word, and I kept looking for the weird stuff. And I would read through Nephi and then 2 Nephi, and I did. We were taught some, I call them caricature beliefs regarding the Book of Mormon. And I did not find one thing that contradicted the Bible. In fact, sometimes I tell my Baptist buddies, the Book of Mormon is more Baptist than the Baptist hymnal. And it is in places. It really is. It's jammed packed full of what I call cardinal themes of Protestantism. I've been invited to speak in Baptist churches, Pentecostal churches, and the way I present the Book of Mormon is essentially that is Christ-centered. So whether or not you're Baptist or Methodist or Pentecostal or whatever, I approach it through the lens of the same Jesus that I met as an 11-year-old lad in a Baptist church, I discovered in this book. That's my approach, is the centrality of the Lord Jesus Christ. I tell my Baptist friends, I feel like I have been born again, again.
How do you like that? Born again, again. What'd you think of that, Roy? Is that your your experience where you were born again?
I was listening to him. He's got a nice voice too. I mean, he just knows how to.
Oh, you've listened to him? I didn't know that. Where'd you hear him?
No, I said just now. I listen to a lot of people, but it's really good to hear somebody. It helps for me to pursue some of the people I known in the past, you know, that are in Pentecostal churches or, you know, Baptist churches or whatever, Lutherans and stuff. You know, brother, how he approached it and how he looked at it is pretty cool.
Yeah, you could see he was on the verge of emotion right there.
Yeah.
At one point when he was talking about he couldn't get out off the first page before he knew that it was from God.
Yeah, because he studied the Bible and he knew it very well, you know, and by doing that, if they just open your hearts instead of being negative towards it, you know, they can, you know, anybody can tell. I mean, that's the problem. People don't want to read it because they're afraid of it. They're thinking it's of the devil, and that's where you come, you know, you think, oh, yeah, you're right. You know, Dr. Martin put a lot of crap in people's heads.
Yeah, really. Have you heard of this guy before, Sam?
No, I haven't, but there ought to be a way to separate previous conceptions of the Book of Mormon and Mormonism from the Book of Mormon so that it can be enjoyed in that way. And the Book of Mormon does have that type of effect on people, on many people. My wife being one of them, she opened the Book of Mormon and it was instantly taken in, and she read it in a week. And she says it changed her life.
Yeah, so many times that happened. So many times, and she's from Chile, so I know that's why that's the case. this film, like I said, I couldn't download. I luckily found this part that I wanted, but it's about an hour long, a little short of an hour long, and you can go watch it on BYU TV. It's I should put a link up for it, but I think if you just did a search on that name, A New Day for the Book of Mormon, you can find it. And it starts off kind of like Meet the Mormons. It's on the streets of Salt Lake City they're interviewing people, and the first part of it there was very interesting interviews with these people, because, you know, at least one of them said, I tried to get tickets to it, he said, but it's out like a year, 2 years out. So all he knew was the musical, you know. Let me, if you go, Andrew, if you just Google a New Day for the Book of Mormon, it will come up. It's up on BYU TV. Maybe we can.
Yeah, I found it.
Did you?
Yeah.
Can you play it? Because I can't get the sound very well.
Yeah, let me see if it'll work. I can share my screen here. Oh, it's asking me to embed it. No, okay, got that. All right, yeah. Let me, it might not, it's got, you know, because sometimes it won't work if I'm streaming and it does full screen, but.
Yeah, I know.
And this is kind of small, so that might be an issue, but we can try.
Well, I can put it up full screen while you play the audio. Or we
okay.
Let me try that. Just want to play the first few minutes of it anyway.
All right. Just let me know.
Okay, you go ahead. It's playing. See, I'll stop it here till you get caught up to pride there. So where are you?
Oh,
We might not be able to tell, so let's just see what we go. What we
it said Galileo Galilei.
Oh, yeah, that's at the beginning. Okay, yeah. I'll slow down until that catches up.
Okay, yeah, it's showing the city. Is it loud
so
enough?
We're asking people, what do you
yeah,
know?
It's coming through.
Nothing at all.
I have absolutely no clue.
Actually, I don't know anything about it. I wanted to go see it, but the ticket wait time right now, I think it's somewhere around a year and a half, 2 years.
I didn't know.
It's handed down to Joseph Smith from God, supposedly. Joseph Smith found the Book of Mormon, and he read the text that came from God on rocks that he found in the ground, I think. John Smith, and he finds the tablets. I know this actually from the South Park episode. Oh, I got in the copy of the Book of the Mormon, and then I tossed it away, right away. Why? Because I'm a Christian.
Oh.
You haven't read the Book of Mormon. You shouldn't judge a book by its cover. I definitely think I would tell them they should read it. I think if you're questioning any religion or questioning anything about anything, you should be knowledgeable about it before you are quick to criticize it or praise it.
I would love to read it. Yeah, I would like to read it because it will be informative, you know.
Yeah, I'm in the process of finishing reading the Book of Mormon. I want to say I've read the whole thing, but I haven't. From what I've read from it, I've felt, I don't know how to explain it, just warm, I guess.
Here's a text that people take seriously, that they change their lives because of it.
You open the book and you're expecting history stories, but what you don't know unless you really read it is that Jesus is in it from front to the middle to end, and that the book is deeply theological.
For literary theorists, Book of Mormon actually is one of the most fascinating texts that has ever been written.
That book was lying on the floor. I thought, I'm going to pick that book up, and I'm going to read it.
Oh, that's
and
him,
I'm
is it?
Knock on his door. I was thinking to myself, he should know better. I mean, he's educated. He's a psychologist. He ought to know better.
I would say the first thing that really drew me to the Book of Mormon.
Well, I don't know if it's coming through to you.
Jesus came to America.
All right, I'm getting...
this is absolutely fascinating. Oh, there's been an
yeah, it's just way behind on the video.
We find in recent years.
Yeah, I can't cut my audio out for some reason. It's jerking. Let's just cut it out. You know, if we just had...
It shows that guy, though.
...and Beck's equipment and his money, we could put on a great show, but no, we have to put up with this...
Educated.
For free stuff that just doesn't work, you know. And so
thank you.
It's frustrating. Technically, we can't reach the level that we would like to reach. I don't know if we ever will be able to, but yeah, if you can't download, it's fairly presentable if you can download it and play it without having to play it over the air, but you can't do it really when you're trying to broadcast over the air and play, download, and this doesn't work. But anyway, so the interesting part, they interview all these people on New York City streets, and they have, you can see all this misunderstanding and lack of understanding that they have. So the film Meet the Mormons really does probably provide, you know, hey, a real understanding of what the Mormon, what Mormonism is all about. You know, I mean, if you think about it, it's a great way to strike through all this ignorance. I mean, it would take too long to try to say, okay, listen, sit down, and I will explain to you what this is all about. That isn't going to happen. But when they go there and they see those people's lives changed, and as Sam said, it was very moving then that will motivate them to go learn more. So I'm going to stop calling it propaganda. I think it was, inspired, because these people really don't know.
Yeah, I mean, propaganda is not doesn't have to be doesn't have to have bad connotation. It just usually does. And so, yeah, whether or not, when I'm spreading things that I believe are true, that's still my propaganda. At least that's my understanding or overstanding of the definition.
Yeah. Yeah, the people, when you say propaganda, though, they think of spreading falsehoods or, public...
I think it's just shedding positive light on anything, no matter what the truth is. You shed positive on that thing or that group that you're sponsoring, whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah. But rather than try to defend the word propaganda, I think I'll stop using it and just... join in with everybody else that's saying that it's a really moving and worthwhile movie to go see, because what it does, then, in a lot of cases, I'm sure, people go there seeing, we would go there and Sam's investigator went there to learn more about it, right? More about the Book of Mormon, more about what it means. And there's other sources for that, but the vast majority of those people going to see it are going to leave there with some kind of motivation to then learn more, So when they hear missionaries or somebody else saying, what do you know about Mormonism and would you like to know more, then will be more effective, that question. So I think it's good, but this Book of Mormon, A New Day for the Book of Mormon, is really great. Now, I have one of the guys also on it was this guy whose name is Terry Gibbons, and we heard him last week when he was talking about some things, and I can't remember exactly what it was we were showing then. Boy, how quickly it fades. But anyway, here he is again on the Book of Mormon and the reason why he has written his books and things the way he has and done his scholarship. And he got into the anti-Mormon stuff and he's trying to, get them to see things. But I haven't really heard all this clip, just the beginning of it, but I'm going to play it. And we'll talk about it. Maybe we can pause it as we go on.
Welcome to the FAIR Podcast. The Foundation for Apologetic Information and Research is a nonprofit organization dedicated to providing well-documented answers to criticisms of...
Sorry. Let me share this first. Oh, come on. There's a delay. And I look for the green share button, but it won't come up, and so... I click and then it comes up, and because I clicked, it goes away. Then I go through that over and over. Let's see, this is it.
In the second project, which I did for Oxford, I thought that it was time to turn attention to the Book of Mormon itself. So one way that I did that was I tried to avoid even mentioning Joseph Smith until as late in the book as was possible. Because as soon as you mention Joseph Smith, he assumes center stage and the Book of Mormon recedes into the background. And so I tried to do just a kind of formal overview of the Book of Mormon. What are its themes? What are its main characters? How does it constitute itself? What is the narrative strategy that's employed? And I hope I carried that off.
And that sort of approach seems to be a little different from what you saw early Mormons doing with the Book of Mormon. And by the hand of Mormon, like you mentioned, you see it as sort of, they viewed it as a sign. Prophecy is back. Joseph Smith is a prophet. Would you qualify that at all now that you've had some distance from that book? Did you find more that sustained that thesis or more to qualify it?
Well, the more work that I've done into early church history and theology, especially looking at the work of Harley Pratt seems to be an exception to the general rule, and that he found the Book of Mormon worth. He found that it was doctrinally rich and substantive, but I think he was by far the exception. The more you study early Mormon proselytizing, for example, the more one becomes convinced that the missionaries were primarily using the Book of Mormon as a sign that Joseph was a prophet. They testified much more about the testimony of the witnesses, read from the testimony of the witnesses more than they would read for doctrinal import.
Do you think that played into the cultural expectations? Did they want that kind of more proof? Did they want that more concrete connection with angels? Here are men who beheld the plates.
Well, absolutely. In the first generation of Mormonism, of course, Western religious culture in general was immersed in a millennialist worldview. And so the Book of Mormon was Exhibit A in the list of evidence that God had reopened the heavens, that miracles were again happening, God was interacting with humans. And so the Book of Mormon was a kind of sacred icon, a sacred relic that was a physical or tangible embodiment of God's interaction with the world.
You mentioned Book of Mormon wars, and from that I gather it's the idea of whether or not it's a true history or whether Joseph Smith wrote it or someone else. There's an interesting part in your introduction to the Book of Mormon here where you're talking about the Anthem experience where Martin Harris takes the characters to Professor and tries to get him to verify these things. And later on, Anthem said, hey, that, you know, I didn't say that this was accurate or anything like that. And Martin Harris walked out of there convinced that Joseph was getting it right. So you write that in a pattern that perfectly epitomizes Book of Mormon wars to the present day, detractors and believers alike found in the episode clear collaboration of their respective positions. And near the end of the introduction, you talk about how you kind of expect that to continue. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, it seems that the race, if you will, to win the Book of Mormon wars by conclusively demonstrating either that it is a 19th century production or that it is an early American artifact has been going on neck and neck from 1830 to the present. I mean, Alexander Campbell lobbies the first salvo when he claims to have found in the Book of Mormon evidence of all kinds of 19th century borrowings, right? He says it's filled with the preoccupations of the 19th century religious controversies. And then a few years later, Joseph Smith is excited because John Lloyd Stevens has come back from Central America and discovered ruins that seem to corroborate the Book of Mormon's story of ancient, highly sophisticated civilizations. And it's gone back and forth like that ever since. Archaeologists find stone altars in Yemen with an inscription of the name Nahum, which seems to corroborate Book of Mormon historicity, just as other anti-Mormon archaeologists conclude that there isn't a single whisper of evidence anywhere in the record in the Western Hemisphere to corroborate the Book of Mormon. Mormons invoke word prints or Hebraisms, and the opposition continues to uncover more and more examples of 19th century cultural similarities that are rather suspicious. And it's my personal belief that it will never be definitively resolved one way or the other.
One thing that Alexander Campbell also brought up was the profound Christology of these supposedly pre-New Testament Israelites. And you talk a little bit about that in terms of Prisca Theologia. What do you mean by Prisca Theologia? How does that come to bear on the early Christology of the Book of Mormon?
Well, this is another example of where the exact same evidence that supports Mormons in their faithful account strengthens the arguments of the opposition, depending on how you construe the evidence. In other words, Joseph Smith created a vision of the gospel as something that goes all the way back to Adam. And if that's true, then one would expect to find elements of the true gospel in all ancient traditions that precede by centuries the Christian era. When you find in a text like the Book of Mormon evidence that 600 years before Christ, people were using his name and teaching his gospel, Mormons would say, well, see, that's just one more example of how ancient the gospel is. Whereas a non-Mormon would say, see, that's proof positive of the fact that we have all kinds of anachronisms here that undermine the historicity of the Book of Mormon.
Okay, and in your study of the Book of Mormon, for this very short introduction, you close the book by talking about the impact that the Book of Mormon will continue to have on Mormons, and also it seems a hope that the more non-Mormons will gain interest in the book. But you quote a fellow named Sidney Ahlstrom, I believe he was a religious studies scholar, and in 1972 he said, "A few isolated individuals can still read the Book of Mormon as a religious testimony, but not even loyal Mormons can be nourished by it as they were a century ago." So he saw it as becoming more and more irrelevant. And what's your take on that?
Well, I think what he said was demonstrably true up until the era of Ezra Taft Benson. And I think that he effected a successful paradigm shift in centering the Book of Mormon in the Mormon consciousness. And I think to this day, it's far more common for members of the church to spend time studying the Book of Mormon on a daily or weekly basis than it is for them to be reading the Bible. And I think they do that in and find exactly that spiritual nourishment which he thought was absent.
In the introduction, you decided to focus on some of the themes of the Book of Mormon and bring a literary analysis to bear on it. And some of the things you point out are really interesting. I was interested in a very simple comparison that you made between the opening of the Book of Mormon and the opening of the Book of Genesis. So if you opened up the Bible and began to read versus if you opened the Book of Mormon and began to read, you get some of the differences there.
Well, the Bible is conspicuous as an example of cosmic history. It purports to give us the history of all things, of the created universe, and it begins with this kind of portentous in the beginning, and we have God, and we have chaos, and we have order coming into the universe. And then as the focus narrows, it only narrows very slightly insofar as we have told to us the history and destiny of great nations and great peoples. The Book of Mormon begins with the exact opposite kind of emphasis, where we're given a specific time, a specific place. We're in Jerusalem. It's 600 BC. It's the age of Jeremiah. There's a man named Lehi. He's not the leader of a nation or a great people. He's an individual. Very soon, his life becomes preoccupied with very particular family problems and family divisions and issues. And so what we have is a radical focusing of the Book of Mormon, and by analogy, a focusing of God's interest on individual destinies rather than cosmic or even national histories. And that seems to be one of the great messages and one of the great emphases of the Book of Mormon, is the extent to which God is a God of individuals, and the extent to which God's revelations are dialogic revelations that are targeted toward individual concerns rather than matters of great or national import alone.
It seems to me that you believe Mormons take that view and apply it in their own lives. In the Book of Mormon, there still are some pretty striking instances. For example, Alma the Younger, an angel appears to him, or Nephi hears the voice of the Lord and then has a great vision. So we have these dialogic revelations, but some of them in the Book of Mormon, most of them even, kind of seem very grandiose compared to what an average Mormon might expect. How do you think a Mormon can reconcile that?
Well, I think there's no question that just as the gifts faded in the primitive church, so there seems to be a diminishment of the spiritual manifestations and gifts in the restored church. To some extent, that's a function of any church that becomes institutionalized, normatized over time. And to some extent, that was a deliberate strategy on the part of church leaders who wanted to de-emphasize spiritual gifts. I think it's a natural process. I think Mormons have accommodated themselves in some ways by changing the lexicon of scriptural resources that they use in order to identify or define the nature of spiritual experience. For example, instead of focusing on those Book of Mormon episodes where we have angelic visitations or interaction with angelic beings, we emphasize those verses that originally were given to Joseph Smith to describe the translation process that have to do with feelings and impressions and stupors of thought. And that has become the template, if you will, for revelation. So that's one way that Mormons have accommodated themselves to a less charismatic church.
Another thing that's interesting about a literary analysis of the Book of Mormon is what you call the Chinese box structure of the Book of Mormon. What did you mean by that?
Well, Grant Hardy has done the most impressive work in this regard in showing that the Book of Mormon is a literary work of phenomenal complexity. And just keeping track of the genealogy, if you will, of any particular passage or part of the text can be a very difficult enterprise. We have brass plates, which become incorporated into Nephi's record, which become incorporated into the teachings of Abinadi, which become incorporated into the gospel that Alma is teaching, which becomes part of what is read before the people of Zarahemla. And so that's what I mean by this sense of Chinese boxes, that we have scripture that is incorporated and assimilated into ever new and ever burgeoning contexts in a way that doesn't just reveal a literary complexity, but I think it also says something about the nature of scripture, that scripture is infinitely recontextualizable, if you will. And
is that what Nephi means by likening? Is that
exactly, exactly. I mean, what we see in the Book of Mormon is Nephi is as the Midrashist par excellence, right? He can take any scripture and adapt it to his particular time and circumstance. He encourages his readers to do the same, and then I think the Book of Mormon becomes an object lesson in precisely how to do that throughout a period of 1,000 years.
And while Nephi is doing that, it seems, at least the translation doesn't make him seem like the most poetic of writers. You mentioned that searching for literary wonders in the Book of Mormon is a bit like seeking lyrical inspiration in the books of Chronicles or Judges from the Bible. What are some of the lyrical inspirational bits that you have found there in the Book of Mormon that have impressed you?
Well, I think that the poignance and the beauty of the Book of Mormon isn't to be found from any particular passages, though there are some of those scattered throughout. I think that the great dramatic intensity of the Book of Mormon comes from the contrast, the narrative structure that juxtaposes Nephi, who represents the dawn of Nephite history, an era full of hope and promise and great expectations, and this, I mean, the entire destiny of his people lies open before him, with full of promise and potential, and that's contrasted with the almost unbearably tragic story of Mormon, who personally witnesses the utter destruction of his people, who were once so fair and delightsome, in his words. So I think it's a great story of failed hopes, of ruptured families. It's rather like Genesis begins also in family strife, family conflict, and ends with this heart-wrenching scene, right, in Pharaoh's house, where the children of Israel are all reconciled to one another, and it ends in this kind of hymn of unity and these beautiful blessings given to the posterity of Isaac, whereas the Book of Mormon ends in the opposite direction. It ends in apocalypse and destruction, and the only glimmer of hope that transcends this tragic tale is the set of gold plates.
So we have that in a pretty sizable book. And it takes a little time to, I think, dig that out. Why do you think God would use a book like that to get such a message across? Why this book?
Well, that's a good point. Grant Hardy has made the observation that if the Book of Mormon was just to serve as a sign of God's dealings, he could have used a pamphlet. Why almost a 600-page work? Well, I think that if one looks back at the history of the Book of Mormon, one sees that there's been a very slow and very gradual growing appreciation for the value of its content. I've always been struck, for example, by the fact that the most radical innovation of the Book of Mormon in terms of a doctrine is the teaching of the fortunate fall. And yet Joseph Smith never commented on that doctrine, as far as I can tell. Nor did the Pratts. It's a doctrine that is repeated in the Pearl of Great Price, and yet it lay there buried and unnoticed and unappreciated. And so one wonders, well, how many other teachings or doctrines in the Book of Mormon have we not really plumbed the depths of because we haven't turned our attention to it with enough devotion and intellectual rigor?
Yeah, that's one of the doctrines you mentioned in the very short introduction. Is one of the strikingly novel doctrines, she calls this idea of the fortunate fall. What's the most striking difference about that? Then talk a little bit more about the fortunate fall and how that comes to bear on the entire Christian cosmology.
Well, it's almost as if that is the missing piece to render Joseph Smith's theology complete. And we have completed it more or less by insinuation and inference. But Joseph, right, as early as 1832-33, he's already developing his ideas about the pre-existence, the premortal existence of the human spirit. Given the fact that Joseph posits this anthropology that places our human soul in a premortal realm, in the presence of God, with the potential for theosis to become actually like God, it becomes immediately evident that this temporal existence has to be a phase of ascent rather than a time of decline or fall. And that's precisely what is taught in Alma. And yet Joseph, somewhat remarkably, used the language, the Protestant language of the fall throughout most of his ministry. He would refer to Adam's fall, to Adam's transgression, to the fall of man as something that had been remedied by the atonement of Christ. But the Book of Mormon, I think, gives a more accurate and plausible, sensible view, which is that there wasn't any fall. There was a transgression on the part of Adam, but the the ascent, if you will, of the human spirits into the temporal plane was part of the process, eventually leading to theosis, not a setback.
And this is a question that bears more on Mormon theology, and that's sort of the project that you're working on right now is a look at Mormon theology. Tell me a little bit about that project.
I do have a contract from Oxford University Press to write a 2-volume history of Mormon theology. And I'm attempting to do this by positing a few theses. First of all, I want to make the point that, as I said, as early as the early 1830s, Joseph already had fairly well limbed out in his own mind the entire plan of salvation. What he spent the rest of his life doing was filling in details and connecting dots, but I don't believe, as other historians have tended to emphasize, that there were dramatic shifts or changes or evolutions in his religious thinking. I don't think that...
You're talking the periodization.
Exactly. It's become almost commonplace to say, well, there was a Kirtland theology, and then there's a Nauvoo theology, and then there's Joseph the Mystic. Well, certainly there's growth and development, but as I said, if you have the essential anthropology limbed out in 1832, pre-existence, and we come here, the temple exists as that place where pre-existent potential is actualized in terms of eternal durable relationships that lead to theosis, that's the essential theology of Mormonism. And I think virtually every other doctrine and principle can be fit into that scheme in one way or another. And so that, I think, in part is what I am attempting to do, not in order to systematize, but rather to show the coherence of Joseph's thinking and to show the process by which that historically unfolded in the early church and beyond.
And there haven't been very many works specifically dedicated to the idea of Mormon theology. We have Sterling McMurrin did some work on that. More recently, Blake Osler has done some of his own kind of creative Mormon theology in some books from Coford. Why do you think Mormons haven't spent more time looking at the idea of theology in Mormon?
Well, I think the view that has long prevailed and goes all the way back to Brigham Young, one can find in Brigham Young and his successors pretty vitriolic language referring to the enterprise of theology. Hugh Nibley very famously said, theology is what happens when revelation ceases. And so I think Mormons have been very skittish of the word for that reason, and also because theology suggests to most Mormon minds a kind of stasis. And nobody wants to ossify a tradition whose underpinnings are in continual revelation. So the difficulty is, how do you write a historical theology without becoming normative? And that's one of the challenges that, of course, I'll face, is I don't want to presume for a moment to be declaring or arbitrating when there are theological differences or disputes among various leaders who have spoken on theological issues. But if we consider theology as simply a kind of rigorous reflection upon our faith, then it's obvious that we can't, or at least we shouldn't, escape the burden of our own theology.
In doing that, looking at historic thought, as you mentioned, you're going to find some contradictions. You're going to find some church leaders saying one thing and others saying another on various topics. There's a sociologist in the church, Armand Moss, and he has a really interesting quote that you use in your book, People of Paradox. Moss says, "Abandon certainty, all ye who enter herein. Never again will you enjoy the immunity to doubt and ambiguity that went with your previous life. But then the ability to live with perpetual ambiguity is also a trait that distinguishes adults from adolescents." And he's talking about the Mormon tension between certainty and searching. How is that borne out in your research?
Well, I think that this is one of the great cultural challenges that Mormons face. Mormons can be distinguished from other faith traditions in many ways, but one of the most conspicuous to non-members and to visitors to our chapels is the rhetoric of certainty that one finds, for example, in a Mormon testimony meeting. It's an unusual kind of discourse to stand up and say not what you believe, not what your faith is, but what you know. And I think this creates an almost unbearable pressure on that segment of the Mormon populace who don't feel that they can testify with certitude. I think it's a little sad that Mormons tend to remember the spiritual gift that is given in the Doctrine and Covenants, that to some is given to know, but they don't read the rest of the verse that says, and to some is given to believe on their words. And so I think there needs to be more room in Mormon culture for not just the certitude, but the ever-searching heart as well.
How could that room be created?
Well, I think in part it could be created by a more accurate reflection on the life and ministry of Joseph Smith. Jill Durr once said to me that she thought the early church was a mixture of revelation, imagination, and negotiation. And I think that's a great way to describe the prophetic enterprise as Joseph Smith understood it. Joseph Smith was continually reaching out and striving and speculating at the same time that he was having theophanies and heavenly visitations. But he certainly understood that uncovering the fullness of the gospel was a proactive endeavor and not a passive one. I've always thought one of the greatest lessons of his life was that after he had shown the ability to translate plates from an unknown language like Reformed Egyptian, he hired a Jewish schoolmaster to teach him Hebrew, which is a pretty good indication that he felt that we have to add the hard work of perspiration to the gift of inspiration.
And as far as abandoning certainty for you, what are some of the things you've run into in your look at Mormon theology that have left you puzzled?
Well, I don't think anybody's ever going to crack the mystery of polygamy and of the various and, to our mind, strange phases and versions that it went through. I don't know that I have achieved any great insight into those kinds of problems, although I think that one can come closer to understanding what might have been going through Joseph's mind in terms of his quest for kinship, his priority of dynastic relations and family associations and friendship in his ministry. But that's one mystery that will always remain.
There have been some recent developments in Mormon studies, the Joseph Smith Papers Project. There have been some university chairs around the country, some exciting developments. Talk about some of the prospects that you see.
Well, you know, people talk about the late 1960s, 70s as the age of Camelot under Leonard Arrington, and I'm sure they were, but if that's the case, then this may be a second Camelot, I hope, they're about to enter into now. I think that the Mountain Meadows Massacre book, I think the generally positive reception of Rough Stone Rolling, which was a fairly honest and unairbrushed account of Joseph Smith, the rigor and openness with which the Joseph Smith Papers are being produced, presented to the public, all of these are terrific signs of a general a kind of maturity on the part of, I think, Mormon culture to address our past more openly and honestly. And I look and hope we see more of the same kind of developments.
Mormonism's always had an interest in history, I think all the way going back, but it's been a particular type of history and more of an advocacy history. Do you see that continuing? And what are some of the uses behind that type of a history compared to a more strictly academic history?
Well, I think it's been pointed out before that Mormon history for the first 100 and more years was almost always written either by vicious critics or overzealous defenders, and so it's been very hard to stake out a middle ground in Mormon historiography. But I think we're
okay. Well, that's where we're going to end it there. That's about as much as we can take. Any comments from you guys to begin with?
He said something about how Mormons are stuck in the knowing phase in fast and testimony meeting. This is something ingrained in us and trained in us from the beginning, and it would seem an unspoken faux pas to say I believe instead of I know. And it isn't an always accurate thing when we say we know, especially when children say it. For this reason, I've been trying to use the term I have a strong testimony of, and I think that that should be done more in the church than teaching children to say I know.
Yeah, especially when they have no idea. And we all know they have no idea. And it gets back to that idea of propaganda and culture, and it really does open up a difficulty in terms of the collision of, you know, trying to help people understand this is not something Joseph made up. And how do we know that? It's a matter of epistemology. But if we start off as children saying, well, we know, that does produce a problem. Roy, were you going to say something? Your mic is unmuted.
Yeah, I was thinking about when he said that. Of course, I never did all those things because we came from a Baptist background. You know, we went to a Baptist church. My mother never went, but anyway, to me, the testimony. I guess he was talking about kids. To me, the testimony is what really sets you free, realizing that you are on the right track. You are involved with something that is just totally awesome. And to me, a testimony, and I think even when I watch the kids, there's a young fellow that gives out the sacrament. And he'll get up there and he'll give his testimony and he just loves the Lord, period. And I can see that. I mean, I loved the Lord when I was in fifth grade. When I hit the sixth grade, or seventh grade or something like that, I realized, you know, there was the devil, I think. But it was weird because at one time in my life, all the way up to that, I didn't think I was had, you know, I mean, you know, did things, but I always talked to the Lord all the time. And to me, that's, and sharing the gospel is one of the greatest things in the world to be able to have an opportunity. I don't know. I just kind of felt that he was kind of, you know, not agreeing that that was a good thing.
Yeah, because he's in that mix where they are all writing books and everything in the major stream of that Mormon, anti-Mormon, Mormon believer and non-believer context is this idea that you know. And so when you see children up there, but they do have this love of God, you can see it, and love of parents. And so, but even the brethren have been tried to encourage people not to have their little children go up and say those things. Let them learn in primary and bear their testimonies in primary. But
so
I've never seen it work.
Doug, I've got a question. I think that guy's trying to bridge the gap between an ex-Mormon, anti-Mormon, and someone who is so-called active, right? What does it mean when, like, when you say the brethren? Like, I hear people say that in the church. Now, I was not active for a long time. I don't know exactly what that means. Like, when people say that, I don't know. I'm like, I don't know if they're talking about me, if I said something.
No, generally it means the leadership.
Yeah, but I don't know. Authorities. Now, don't we have a prophet, but other than that, I don't necessarily hold to any leadership at all. Like, I'm never going to read what, like, some apostles said. I'm going to read what the prophet said, and then I'm going to read the Book of Mormon and the Bible. That's just me. Now, that may seem like some little arrogant punk talking, but to be honest, there's a lot of leader worship. And I knew what you meant. I just, for me, I feel like he said it right when he said the church is began to have a structure. And then what did he say? You know, what came out of that was a lack of revelation. I mean, that is frustrating to me.
The idea that that it's not as charismatic as before. You know, the idea that we can, in the scriptures, you see the promise of of being able to lay your hands on the sick and they will recover. And a lot of times that happens, but it's a lot of times it doesn't happen. And so, you know, there's no more speaking in tongues. I think that was a part of the earlier church experience. And it's just, they see this. This brings me to my point. My major point in all of this is that nobody, and I mean nobody, but here on this program, mentions the Book of Mormon as a fulfillment of the Bible. We do not hear anybody talking about Isaiah 29 and the marvelous things that are in that chapter and the chapter before it in Isaiah 28 and Isaiah and the chapter after in Isaiah 30 with the breach in the wall and all of that stuff.
Well, the brethren would have told you, so I don't know. That's blasphemy, man.
So that brings me to your point. Yeah, when we read the scriptures, instead of reading what the brethren write in all their books and stuff and the manuals, and just, you know, people try to read through the Book of Mormon by a schedule. Right now our ward has a schedule to read the Book of Mormon, you know. Well,
it's supposed to be precept upon precept, precept upon precept. That's a repetition. That means you study it and you repeat the word and you read it slowly and you use the Spirit. And I don't know. I see a lack of that. Maybe that's just in the wards I've been in. I'm not in every ward, but you know, I think that there's this what the leaders say. I never have looked at what the leaders said unless they are a prophet. And I find the scriptures that we have very, very fulfilling.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, me too. And so, you know, I read them, what they say a lot. I marvel at how well they understand it. What I get out of it is the evidence that they are studying the scriptures. When I see them, you know, really go to the heart of the matter so many times. And I love watching conference to hear their sermons and things. And I wish that I could be as articulate and as perceptive and as spiritual as I see them sometimes. But that doesn't help me. I have to do that myself. You know, I mean, it's a guide, but that's all it is. You know, it's like reading the pamphlet when you go to a historic stop on the road, you know, and there's a little bit there, or maybe a display with a map and telling you a little bit about the history. But if that's all and you ever know about that particular event or milestone in history, and that's all you have is a collection of those roadside pamphlets, you know, you're not going to be able to integrate the whole thing. You're not going to, you have to immerse yourself in it, in the Word of God. And that's one thing I've always admired about my brother Roy. He would love to spend time with the Lord, you know, by himself, where he's reading the scriptures, singing hymns. And that doesn't mean that he doesn't listen to, he really loves the talks and things, but that's not all. He then talks to the Lord himself, see? And if you leave that out, if all you do is listen to what the brethren say, and yeah, that's pretty good, and then you go on and you turn on the television or you do whatever else, and you never have this personal worship time and study time where you are involved, it doesn't do any good. And I think we need to make that more clear. I didn't mean to embarrass you or anything, Roy, but that is really true. I really have admired your desire all the time to do that.
I guess I've always had a desire for the Lord. I fell away a few times. Did some stupid thing. And I'm spending time with the Lord. I want the Spirit to be with me all the time. And Spirit can't be with you unless you're open to it. And that's why sometimes I really like spending time, you know, at night I listen to tapes, and when I go to sleep I'm listening to the spirit, and then I'm, you know, listen to different songs. Anyway, I put earplugs in and I go to sleep on it. And the same with the word. I get into the, you know, like we are with Almond, and that blesses you even more when you sit down and go back and start listening to it again where we're at. And it's like, whoa, it's so heavy.
See, that's your lexicon. That was the word that Terrell Givens used, this lexicon. But see, it's different. Your lexicon here has the word blessed. You know, it's a blessing to. I mean, that's great. You don't very often hear the Mormons use that in that sense, you know, that they're seeking that blessing. They might say that, but they don't talk about being blessed that much. Would you agree, Sam? Or Andrew or anybody?
I agree.
Yeah, I agree.
See, that comes from his non-Mormon background. That's the lexicon that he brings to the church.
That is amazing.
He uses that I can't recall right off, but I pick up on him when he uses those terms.
Yeah, I know, right? Like the way that Roy talks about the Holy Ghost and talking about our connection with our Father on the planet next to the star Kolob, is amazing, and it's different, and it's different from what I've heard. I grew up in the so-called church, and it's the way that he talks about it is definitely different, and it's amazing, and it's really inspiring. It's humbling. Because usually I'm just a hothead and I'm criticizing everything. But, you know, I can definitely see the blessing and the joy of reading these scriptures, especially connecting the two and doing that in private is an amazing thing. And that's something that not everybody, I don't think, gets to experience in their life because of all these stinking distractions.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I really have enjoyed this conversation and the things that we've learned today on the show. Again, I wish we could talk as a church more about the great blessings that the Lord is, the great work that he is bringing to pass, and how that is a fulfillment of Isaiah, and that's why he told us to study Isaiah, and especially chapter 29, but there's much more. We never seem to be able to get to it,
Did it say especially chapter 29?
Yeah, well, I said that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
I agree. 29.
But it's chapter 29 that talks about the Book of Mormon, right? It talks about voices from the dust. It talks about the hypocrisy of the Gentile nation and the judgment that will come upon them. It talks about the great and marvelous work. It talks about the new world order. It talks about the effect that the book will have on the deaf and the blind and the poor among men and the meek. And it talks about the temples.
Talks about the remnant too.
I'm sorry?
Oh, it talks about the remnant as well.
Yeah, and it talks about that remnant when it says that Jacob's face will no longer turn pale when he sees his children, the work of my hands in the midst of him, you know, and how they that erred in spirit will come to understanding, and those that murmured will learn doctrine. I mean, oh, wow, it is just so fantastic. And we never talk about it. I mean, we talk about it on this show, but who else talks about it? Gee, it drives me crazy. What's the matter with you people? You know, this is the greatest thing that we have to share with the Christian world, and we never do it.
Sorry. Yeah, well, it's a slow kill mind control that they have us under. And so, you know, I was under it
and you were under it. And the hard part is convincing people to break out of it. But we live in Babylon. And if people can realize we live in Babylon, then you can finally wake up, realize where you are, and then say, oh, shoot, I don't want this to be Babylon. Let's change it. I mean, would you agree we live in Babylon?
Come out of Babylon.
Yes.
We're not going to change Babylon.
We're not change it.
But we come out, the Lord commands us to come out of Babylon and be clean because Babylon's going to fall.
Yeah. Yeah, it's difficult to do. It's hard. I know that.
But it's not bad enough that they don't understand 1st and 2nd Nephi in terms of the apostasy of the church and then the gathering together of the multitudes in order to fight against the Church of the Lamb, and then the great deliverance, the Lord saying that he'd preserve his people even if by fire, if it's necessary. And then we read in Ezekiel that's exactly what happens in this so-called battle of Armageddon, and so all of a sudden, instead of looking down there at a few acres of ground in the Holy Land, we're looking at a global scale of events that are taking place, and boom, man, our understanding just amplifies. And then we go on and read in 3rd Nephi, how he will gather his people, how the kings will shut their mouths because they will learn things that they didn't know before, and how his people will rejoice and they will see eye to eye when he brings again Zion, and the Gentiles are invited to come unto it. But it's going to be the greatest thing since Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt. But we don't talk about it. I mean, that is the message that is the fullness of the gospel. And it's hardly mentioned.
It's going to be a desert, a wasteland, right? It's going to be a waste. If I'm there, I don't know. But I hope to be there. It's going to be incredible. And if you're with the remnant, the weapons of the enemy do not work on you. It's incredible. Yeah. It is amazing.
Yeah.
There you go.
And that's true. And so Babylon will fall. The New World Order will fall. But Satan will have his own dominion for a while. But in the meantime, the Lord will have Lord will rule over his people. And when he says that his servant will declare that, and there will be those who will not believe it, and because of their unbelief, his servant will be marred, but his life is in the hands of the Lord, and the Lord will heal him and thus show unto the world that that his wisdom is greater than the cunning of the devil, we need to understand that. We need to talk about that. We need to teach what that means. We look in section 101, and we see he tells us how Zion will be redeemed, and he gives us that parable. We need to understand it because it will strengthen us, but can't.
That's why we're doing the show.
Yeah, that's why we're doing the show. That's why we had last Friday, we had a total of 14 people that viewed it.
We're shutting it down. We're shutting it down. They shut our video down. I mean, the FBI and CIA are scrambling right now.
Yeah, they got to stop this movement. it wouldn't be funny if it weren't so tragic, but I keep thinking, what can I do, how can we get a bigger audience, when anybody that goes out and puts their video of their cat playing with the dog gets 10 million views, why in the world can't we at least get 300 or 400 views? Why does it always have to be less than a dozen? I don't know.
Bring your cat to the next program.
Yeah, that's why I tried to show a little bit of Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers because I thought people just get scared away from them. They don't want to see this stuff. They're not going to share it. They don't want to come back. You know, it's probably not even same 14.
The prophet, Ezra Taft Benson, said, I'd love to tell you something sweet, but there's nothing sweet to say. I mean, you can't say it any better, any more tragic than that. Holy cow.
I went over to a family and was talking to him and his wife, and he's a leader, an important leader in our ward. And his wife says, well, and I was talking about these things and the vaccinations and the chemtrails and all this stuff that they, of course, don't want to hear about. And she says, I think we should stick to positive stuff. We shouldn't talk about negative things. The positive will all, and you know, I think, who was it, that Jennifer that once in a while watches the show said something about, you know, you get more with honey than you do with vinegar or something. And that's true. Where do we get the honey, you know? Come, we need to have Christy and some other, females come and sweeten the mix a little bit, maybe, but I don't know. If you have any other suggestions, let me know.
I think Christy was wondering if there, you know, we should find a way to get that Baptist preacher and see if we could interview him.
Oh, that would be fantastic, yeah. Because he probably doesn't care if we only have 25 people, views, 25 views on our videos. He's probably pretty humble about that, you know.
Are you? Do you have a lot of subscriptions to other social networks?
I don't know. I don't really make it a habit of subscribing to a lot of things, but we have a total of 83, I think, that have subscribed to our channel. But maybe, I don't even know for sure what that means.
Maybe by advertising on those social networks, this program, maybe you'll get more viewers.
Yeah, but I actually have a page on Facebook that's called Voices from the Dust, and I post this show every day on there, with a link to go to it. And there's 180 subscribers to that. No, 180 likes. 180 likes to that page. But I don't know what that means. Do they automatically, if they like it, do they automatically get the notices that the posts that I post on the page? Does that post to their timelines?
Well, this is like the blind leading the blind, because I haven't done that much advertising myself on other social networks, but so
yeah,
that's just a suggestion.
Yeah, I'm the same. I don't have Facebook, and I don't really have any friends, so.
Yeah.
People are scared.
Find somebody that is really good at that. I don't know if it's Christy that's all, you know, we almost always have one viewer, and I always imagine in my mind, you know, during the live show, that one viewer is Christy. I don't know if it's her or not. Maybe she could text you and let us know if she's watching right now. But we need more like her, you know. They could watch this or listen to it at work. They don't have to watch it, but they could listen to it on their phones at work. And if that's working and we spread the word, you know, maybe we can get more. But again, a lot of people don't want to hear what we have to say, so I don't know.
Do you have keywords that you have put up that apply to search engines?
Yes, every program there's a keyword search box on the YouTube thing that's connected with the Google Plus, and I fill that up.
Maybe some of those
keywords as I can think of.
Maybe some of those keywords should be like Mormonism debunked, or
would get a lot of
truth behind Mormonism, the fallacies of Joseph Smith's prophecies, or something like that.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah, there's a lot of those people. But anyway, we had Bomo on for a while, and he was one of those. But Roy chased him off, so because he said, "You're quenching my spirit."
Why did he? What happened?
Are we getting off the air, Doug?
No, we're still on the air, buddy. No. Go ahead.
Yeah, David Pittenhauer is listening.
You know what you were saying about Bomo, and he never came back. You hurt his feelings, I think.
Oh, I didn't mean to hurt his feelings. I was just telling the truth. You know, the spirit is the most important thing in our lives. And if you're gonna quench our spirit, it isn't. You know, that's a negative tone or whatever. But I understand people have an opinion, but you know. You can't make fun of Christ. You can't make fun of, you know, other things of the church, because I don't stand for it. I'm sorry, but I won't stand for that.
And that's good. I'm glad you did, because I was getting a little heated at times with Bomo, and that wasn't good. That doesn't help anybody. It might increase our viewership. I'll tell you what increased our viewership more than anything else for whatever episode is that's when I said we were having W, the Intel Insider, and B, the Guerrilla Economist.
You got all the conspiracy theorists.
Yeah, we had like 3,000 of them have watched.
I saw that video. I know, man. That was the crowning jewel.
Yeah, so well, if we could open up a dialogue with Hagman and Hagman, man, we would really have a tremendous readership, or, you know, our numbers would go up increasingly, but no, they just cut us off. They don't want to talk to us. Somebody needs, besides me, I think if I write to them, they see my name, they don't even read it probably, because there for a while I was writing to them so much that Steve Quayle says, if you don't stop writing to me, I'm going to put you on my blacklist or whatever it is.
Oh, Steve Quayle, just trying to sell for a buck.
Yeah, so I never wrote him since. I never have sent him, and that's been a couple of years ago. But every once in a while, I'll write Hagman and Hagman and point out something, you know, but they never answer. Never, never. At least Steve Quayle answered for a while. But
hey, Joel Skousen, that's the man right there. He'll answer emails, too. I've emailed him a few times.
Yeah, he's, you know, I have a special place for Skousen because I was there with Cleon at BYU. Took classes from him and you know, had sessions, what do they call them, office hours with him. And
wow.
I still have some things that I need to get back in his file cabinets that I borrowed.
Oh, are you serious? Let's read that. That's awesome.
I don't know where they are anymore. Anyway, it's great that you guys come and we can talk about this stuff. I love it when we can exchange ideas and discuss different points of view, but especially love the fact that we all love the Book of Mormon and can appreciate it. And now we see, go ahead and watch this movie. You'll see a lot of scholars and a lot of different things, people talking about how the Book of Mormon is not to be taken lightly. You know, these people didn't realize what they were messing with when they started dissing it. And, of course, that implies that Joseph Smith was a prophet of God. And it would be interesting to have Lynn Ridenour on so we could find out why he can accept the Book of Mormon but reject its actual message. You know, so that would be interesting.
Well, but, I do have insight on that.
Oh?
I do. I was working with this guy who was, and really, I'm not big on titles, but he's, you know, he's in the state presidency. I don't care. But He claimed to know and be a part of some leadership, whatever. I don't care about leaders, except for the prophet, just by the way. But he did tell me, he said that, and this was a few months back, and he was talking to me about how there are different roles that the Lord will give us, and this was his words, and that that he knew of a, and he may have been talking about Lynn, but he said he knew of a Baptist minister that had come to the church and had asked to be baptized, and the so-called leadership told him not to. And they said, no, your work will be done for you, and your role is better served staying in that church and preaching those sermons where you do now. Which was, you know, this is what he told me. I don't know if that happened. There's no proof, but that's just what he said. And I was like, oh, that's really interesting.
Yes, that would be amazing. And you could see, you know, with him preaching to various congregations, and he doesn't do much online. I went to his YouTube channel. It's pretty outdated, and there's not much there. But, yeah, that would be fantastic. And maybe we could get him together with Dave Bartoszewicz.
And we can have some kind of
Dave Bartoszewicz show, you know, with Lynn Ridenour. You know, how fantastic would that be? But
that would be so cool.
I'll explore that. I'll see if I can get a hold of the guy on the phone or something and talk about it. And I'll ask him this. I'll call it a rumor that you've heard, and see if he's the guy that they were talking about or something. I don't know. There may be more than one. He calls it a movement, a restorationist movement.
I know. That would be great.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll talk about that more, I guess, further down the line. But I'm grateful for everybody and hope you have a great day. And as always, my prayer is that the Lord's choicest blessings will be with us all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.